Thank you, Wendy, for the wonderful introduction. And let's get started with the, let's say, the part concerning Ruby on Rails. And in particular, the goal of this webinar is that of providing a kind of a high level and non-technical introduction to web development and the Ruby on Rails framework. We have been using Rails for 10 years now, and we have been happy developers with this technology for 10 years, and we are happy to share our experience and do some publicity and promote the use of this technology. And of course, given, let's say, the time, and given that this is not going to be a tutorial to become a proficient programmer, we're more interested in the, let's say, management aspects, even though I'll try and get into some details of, let's say, how the technology works. Of course, there are many nice resources if you want to become a proficient Ruby programmer, and let's say we will make them available on our web pages. Okay. Let me go to the next slide. Okay. And basically, there are three topics I would like to cover today. And so I have divided, let's say, the presentation in three parts. The first part is going to be an introduction to web applications. I mean, we all use web applications every day. I mean, Gmail, Drive, and many other applications. But I thought it would be nice and it could be interesting to, let's say, just get a bit more into the details of how a web application works, because the information we will get in the first part will help me explain, and I hope, let's say, make clear how a web development framework such as Ruby on Rails can help build web applications, which is going to be covered in part two of this presentation. And finally, in part three, I would like to, let's say, conclude with some considerations about the kind of changes and the kind of, let's say, advantages you can get by adopting a web development framework to develop and build web applications. Okay, so let's start with part one, and let's start with a very high level definition and view of what a web application is. By taking the definition from Wikipedia, basically we can say a web application is basically a client-server application in which interaction happens mainly through a browser. Or if you want to look it at in a slightly different way, you may think of a web application as a way of accessing resources on the web whose content is dynamic rather than static. So on the one end, if you look at the picture, we have on the left-hand side the client, which is typically a browser. And of course, you know there are many different browsers you can use, and that will have an impact on the kind of, let's say, constraints we have in building web applications. On the left-hand side, we have a client sending a request to the server on the right-hand side. And the right-hand side, basically the server, answers to the request by providing content back to the client. And let's say if we get into slightly more details into what a request looks like, then we can say that a request is mainly made of three parts: a verb or request, a URL or resource, and a list of parameters we pass to the server. The verb or request is one of nine different and standardized actions we ask the server to perform for us. The most known and popular ones are get and post, which basically corresponds to a request for getting some data, as you may imagine, or storing some data on the server, simplifying a bit. But in general, the verb encodes the kind of action we want to perform. The second thing we specify in a request is the URL. The URL is, an internet address, which basically allows to specify the kind of resource we want to access on the server, the kind of code we want to execute on the server. And the third element, the parameters, is the list of arguments which we pass from the client to the server. For instance, when we need to, let's say, submit some data or change the behavior of the web app according to our input. And this structure of the request, of course, is the same for any URL we access on the web, whether it is, let's say, a static website or a web application. But let's say, of course, it works for web applications. And below, you find an example of a request. And the example is a search we may want to perform with Google, for instance. So basically, the URL we write is, well, www.google.com, and the resource we want to access is the search resource corresponding to a piece of code which is executed in some of the servers running at Google. The verb is not shown by the browser, but in this case, it will be a GET. And the parameters is the part in the URL which is encoded, the part in the address, sorry, which is encoded after the question mark, namely Q equals ITM PI. And basically, this is a way of, let's say, passing to the server the parameter Q, which has got as value ITM PI. And as you may imagine, the result of, let's say, performing this request on google.com is exactly that of getting the results of searching for ITM PI on the net. And matter of fact, let's say, what happens when we type on the Google search input box ITM PI, we send this kind of request to the server. More in details, if you're curious enough, I'm showing in this slide the exact, let's say, list of parameters which get passed if you perform an actual search on Google. And as you may see, the first part of the, let's say, of the address is exactly the same, www.google.com/search. And then we get a bunch of parameters, among which the Q parameter I was telling you about earlier. And the ampersands separate different parameters. So in this case, every time you search on Google for something, Google sends to the server, your browser sends to the server other information such as the parameter EI and OQ and blah, blah, blah.
Hi there. I hope you enjoyed that last clip. My name is Michael Malutis, and if you'd like to watch the full 60 minutes of that last webcast, while also gaining complete unlimited access to our entire library of IT learning, simply visit our subscribe page at greatpro.org/subscribe. Unlimited annual access is $199 per year, but if you use the coupon code LEARNTOEARN, you can drop that membership fee to just $149. That's less than $13 per month for unlimited access to over 1,000 hours of on-demand career development, covering the entire spectrum of IT management best practices, including business analysis and requirements, software development, quality and testing, risk management, process improvement, project management, and even digital transformation. But your membership doesn't just give you unlimited access to our vast learning library. You also get free access to our mobile app, as well as direct access to our network of over 300 of the world's leading IT consultants, all of whom are dedicated to putting practical knowledge at your fingertips so that you can learn more and earn more. I hope you will join me in becoming a member of the Great IT Professional and advancing your career with us. And if you're on YouTube, don't forget to hit that subscribe button above so that you get notified whenever we publish new free webcasts each week of the year. Thank you for your time and best wishes for your continued success.